Fridays are awesome. Love starting out like that. I'm Carl Azus for CNN 10. First story we're explaining today takes us to an island nation famously said to be 90 miles away from Key West, Florida, but which has a very different system of government than the U.S. Cuba is a communist state. Its leadership has strict control over the media, the internet. The Communist Party is the only legal party on the island, and Cuba's new leader wasn't elected by the people, but rather Cuba's legislative branch, its National Assembly, which almost always votes unanimously for whatever the president proposes. With that president, Raul Castro, planning to retire more or less, that National Assembly has just named Miguel Díaz-Canel its new president. This is the first time in almost six decades that Cuba won't be led by a man named Castro. In fact, when former President Fidel Castro led Cuba's communist revolution in 1959, Díaz-Canel hadn't been born yet. The 57-year-old first vice president is the unopposed candidate to replace Cuba's current leader, and Díaz-Canel is expected to keep the status quo in Cuba, closely following the leadership of the Castro presidents, while Raul Castro will keep a powerful leadership position and have the final say on important decisions. People expect things will stay the same under likely President Díaz-Canel. The communist government's supporters on the island say it'll continue on its course even without the Castros. Opponents will likely have to wait longer to see any significant change. 10-second trivia. What is the fattiest organ in the human body? Is it the skin, the brain, the liver, or the stomach? The human brain is almost 60% fat, making it the fattiest organ we have. There's a new study out that suggests concussions and even more serious brain injuries might carry an increased risk of developing Parkinson's disease later in life. This disorder has symptoms like shaking uncontrollably, trouble keeping balance, and slow movements, and there's no cure for it. The study looked at the medical records of more than 300,000 military veterans. Now, it's important to point out that relatively few of these people, less than 1%, ever developed Parkinson's disease, even though half the veterans in the study had had some form of brain injury. But among the nearly 1,500 who did develop Parkinson's, almost 950 had had a traumatic brain injury, while just over 500 had not. Researchers concluded that brain injuries carried a greater risk of developing Parkinson's later on, at least among those who actually got the disease. It's one example of how scientists are constantly exploring the brain for symptoms of injuries that could lead to earlier diagnoses and maybe even a cure for brain diseases.
In order to protect athletes, tech is studying one of our smallest features.
When your eyes are working normally and you're following something across your field of vision, your eyes will smoothly track that. When somebody has a concussion, suddenly the ability to track that becomes very erratic and your eyes are having trouble focusing. So they move in very varied patterns and varied speed. So we can pick up a concussion using the eye guide focus.
Your ability to follow an object with your eyes is called tracking. A concussion breaks down how your brain and eyes normally talk to one another, so smoothly tracking after a bad hit is difficult. That's what the Eye Guide Focus records. Your results are taken before and after an event.
So you can see in the blue was the baseline he did before the bout. The green was about 5 minutes after he had what we call a flash knockout, a very quick knockout. And this is a much heavier fighter who won, but if you notice, again, the blue is the baseline where you see a very smooth figure of eight, and the red is after the bout. It's a supplement to the physician evaluation and the normal criteria that we follow, changes in speech, memory, concentration, reaction time, and eye movements.
Right now, there's no single diagnostic tool to determine if someone has a concussion, so doctors use a combination of tests, like asking you to repeat numbers or a phrase and checking your hearing and balance to figure out what's happening inside your head.
After concussions and other mild traumatic brain injuries, often the MRI and the CAT scans do not show any pathology, and so we really are dependent on our clinical exam to understand where the problem is. And there are a lot of different ways to look at the neurological function of the patient, but eye movements are something that we can look at and quantify.
Even though we're a couple weeks past Ramen Noodle Day, yes, there's a Ramen Noodle Day, it's on April 4th, we're still reporting on the culinary creation. The holiday in its honor is observed in the U.S., but that's not where ramen noodles were invented. To fill you up on interesting info about the history of ramen, we're passing the mic to our friends at Great Big Story. If you or someone you know has struggled to assemble furniture, this could be a welcome sight, at least if you've bought a solid pine Stefan chair from IKEA. That's what researchers in Singapore taught this robot to build. It failed a few times along the way, but it eventually learned to observe, plan, and finally assemble the chair, taking a little over 19 minutes to do it if you don't count the 3 years researchers spent programming the robot. So was it a good IKEA? You can at least see what the big IKEA was. It's far easier to have a seat than to build one. And if you're the chair of a research lab, you want to make sure a project stands on its own before you sit back and chair at the results. Oh yeah, seat puns. They always have a leg to stand on. I'm Carl Azus, and CNN 10 hopes you have a great weekend.